Hi, I'm David Loch. We have three galleries across Canada. I started the one in Winnipeg 43 years ago, and then we opened the second one here in Toronto 13 years ago, and then 10 years ago we opened in Calgary. As I have three sons, all in the business, so there's two of them in Toronto, one in Calgary, and then occasionally I'm back in Winnipeg, and we have that, of course, as a fully staffed gallery. And we have always specialized in historic Canadian art, but we also have a very good, stable, living Canadian artist. And I'm a little different than your normal dealer, because I also believe in building museums. And so in Winnipeg, we built built the first sculpture garden in Canada. My friend Hockley Richardson in Winnipeg, which is 30 years ago, did two huge additions to it, and it's been a huge tourist attraction now, a wonderful place to go for the work of Leo Mall, who was my first artist when I opened in 1972 in Winnipeg. It's a huge park, huge garden, a place even physicians recommend people go to relax.
Mentioned Ivan Eric and Michael.
And then we also, then after I did that, we took the second most recognized piece of architecture in Manitoba, which was the pavilion at Assiniboine Park, in the same park where the garden is. And I dreamed about what that place could become. It had never been heated. It was used in the latter years as an ice cream stand and a hot dog stand. Criminal for a piece of architecture like that. But I dreamed about what the place could become. And so with the help again of my friend Hockley Richardson, we raised $5 million to put a new building inside the old one. And then Ivan Eyre gave me 200 paintings, 5,000 drawings, and 16 sculptures. And then another collector that I met when I first came to Canada, he became a lifelong friend. He gave me 650 WGA Phillips watercolors and woodcuts. So that particular museum is exclusively for those two people. And that's been open now, I guess it's about 15 years. So, and then we went on to build a sculpture garden at McMichael for Ivan, nine monumental sculptures of Ivan Eyre's. It was given as a gift by Ivan. And I managed to get that all done. And if you go there today, it looks like it's been there forever because it's so beautifully landscaped. And that to me is really the important things in life, not business. Business is fun, and it's nice to do well in business. But the important thing is leaving a footprint as to why you're here. And so you do those sort of things, then they'll be here long after I'm gone. And that to me is critically important. I dealt with Ken Thomson for 15 years, probably maybe a little more, where as chief advisor to Ken and what to do with the collection as it was starting to grow. And so Ken never made a move without me. And we had a wonderful relationship, the finest man I've ever known.
In the arcade, the collection that he has of the
And painters. Of course, I always talk to Ken about what I'd done in Winnipeg and so forth, and hoping that one day that Ken would make the right decision and give his things back to the people. Because as far as I know, nobody's ever figured a way to take it with them. And so Ken...
David donated a lot of Ken's collection to the AGO.
Well, the collection is on three floors there. That was it was always Ken's intention that that happened. And that's in place now, you know, with the design of Frank Gehry. And it's quite a wonderful space. And filled with a lot of the treasures that I acquired for Ken. But of course, his taste varied, you know, greatly outside of just Canadian borders. He had a wonderful collection.
He's got the,
outside of that, in European works.
He's got the one that the Rubens, which is
well, the Rubens, the Massacre,
the Massacre
of the Innocents. And of course, that was a record price at auction in London. It's a wonderful painting, very disturbing painting.
In 10 minutes, it sold.
Wonderful painting.
David bought it in 10 minutes.
Yeah, it's it was great. It was great fun to watch all that. But Ken had just an insatiable appetite for art, and it was the greatest joy was to try and help him do it with the right pieces that made a difference. Because it's so tempting just to keep buying. But my philosophy with Ken from the very beginning, I said to Ken, was very simple. We buy the best and we leave the rest. And it's a very hard thing to do. You might think it's an easy statement, It's the toughest thing to do in life, because without discipline, you can't do it. So one has to be totally disciplined if you're going to do it correctly. And that's what I tried to install into a great extent. I was very successful with Ken because he trusted what I was telling him. He didn't buy every single thing, but he bought most of the material that I was suggesting that we should do at that particular point in time. I still miss him every day.
We all do. How long was your relationship with Ken?
It was probably a little over, again, I'm hopeless thinking back, a little over 15 years, I think. And Ken phoned me twice a day, no matter where he was. And he was wonderful. And he just said to me, "David, use your discretion."
Well, it found a great home in the AGO.
It has, yeah. I mean, it's nothing nicer than giving it back to the people. I mean, you can sell it back in auction and turn it all back into dollars and cents. That's totally meaningless, because you never put it together again. It's like this collection of Walter Phillips that I just bought. It took me 42 years to get this collection of art. It's impossible to have done what I've done, but it took me 42 years.
Where did you find the Phillips?
In Winnipeg. So patiently waiting for when the timing would be right to do it. So in Phillips' lifetime, he came to Canada in 1913, and he did his first block print in 1917. So he worked from 1917 to the mid-40s, where he produced 149 color woodcuts. I have every one. It's impossible to do that, because one of them only has two copies.
It's possible for a person who has drive and instinct, and especially a family that supports that.
Oh yeah, and of course, now we actually own it, because I've written the check off, so we do that. No, we're not going to sell it. We're not going to sell it unless we find one buyer. Because as soon as we break it up, it'll never happen again. So it's always the money is the meaningless thing. You need money to survive. You need money to do things.
It's the most important thing to leave our legacy. Because these trade shows are really international. It's become more and more prominent. We have galleries from all over the world.
Well, it's interesting you've asked me to speak about just a little bit of Kreighoff. Obviously very important in Canadian history and recording art of the period. The mid-1800s on, a little bit, and some of them are dated, and a lot of them aren't, but he was recording what life was like in Quebec and so forth. And of course, Ken Thomson had the collection of works. And people have asked me, sometime, how did you get ever to meet Ken Thomson? And I said, when I started to become a little bit successful, and you must remember, I started with $400 in Winnipeg, which was, you should not survive with $400. but fortunately, I paid tax my first year and every year after. But I could never have done without Toronto. So Toronto was the key for me to develop clients and try and make a living in the art business. And as I got, closer to some of the clients that I was working well with, one of them said to me one day, "You should go and see Ken Thomson. You would get along well with him." And I said, "No, I don't want to go and knock on doors. I'm a great believer in faith. If we're meant to meet, we'll meet. And if not, I'm doing okay." And so there's one night in a Waddington sale in Toronto, keep in mind I was in Winnipeg, the only time it's ever happened, because I always go to a sale at least 3 days ahead of time to check and see what's coming up and what's happening for condition. I phoned Ron McLean, the father of the boys that run the place now. And I said to Ron, "I can't get there until half an hour before you start." And so I said, "Could you keep me two free seats in the front row?" And I'm the guy with my back against the wall all the time. So he did. So Ken Heffel was alive then. So Ken came and joined me up front, make sure we weren't conflicting on lots. And there was this Kreighoff coming up. And so I turned to my friend Ken Heffel and asked him if he had checked the condition. He said he did. The condition was fine. I said, "Were you interested?" He says, "No." I said, "I like it. I'm going to see if I can buy it." But because I was sitting in the front row, which you'd never hear at the back, I was sitting next to the bank of telephones where they were taking phone calls. And all one young lady said was, "I can't get him." And I turned to my friend Ken Heffel and said, "That's Ken Thomson, he can't get him. I'm buying the picture for sure now." So I bought the painting. And after the sale, I went up to Ron McLean and said, "You can tell him that I bought it. No name. But I'll be in the hotel room until 1 o'clock tomorrow." And And Ron phoned me in the morning at 9 o'clock. He says, David, he wants the painting. He wants to know how much you want for it. And I said, well, you must tell him you must speak with me personally. I won't sell the painting before I've spoken to him. And I'll be in the room till 1 o'clock. And at that time, Ken still owned the Hudson Bay Company. And just happened to be the annual meeting for the Hudson Bay. So he phoned me from his car phone at noon. And it was small talk because we had never spoken before. And he says to me, I understand you bought a painting I was interested in last night. And I said, yes, I did. He says, well, how much do you want for it? I said, well, I'll be perfectly honest with you, Mr. Thomson. I'm more interested in getting to meet you and see your collection than I am in making money from something I've just bought. He says, well, let me tell you something. There's a lady sitting in the car with me who speaks very highly of you. Whether we do a deal here or not, doesn't matter. You're welcome in my home or office at any time. And it took me a year to find out who the mystery lady was. It was our lieutenant of the governor's wife of Manitoba, Dawn McCagg, who was sitting in the car, and she was on the board of the bay. And so Ken said, now I've got to get back to my meeting, David. Tell me what you want for the picture. And I said, well, you know what I pay. Whatever you say is fine. And he gave me an enormous profit. I didn't know what to say. I'm seldom speechless, but I was speechless. And then after that, we met. And that's when I sat him down with David, because he called his son David into the room, to listen to my very simple philosophy in life, is we buy the best and we leave the rest. And from that day forward, when Ken was alive, I was the advisor to Ken in the collection. And he was such a wonderful man. There'll never be another one like him, because he was so totally unique. Never once did I hear him raise his voice. Never once did I see him mistreat anybody. And I spent a lot of time with him. And so to be able to say that about a human being who was the wealthiest man in the country, who had this gentle soul about him from start to finish, everything about him was real. He had both feet solidly planted on the ground. There was no airs or graces. I used to say to him, Ken, can you imagine if I had still lived in Scotland, in the little village I was brought up in, and I tried to get close to somebody like you, I wouldn't have got within 5 miles. And Ken would just chuckle.
I got close.